Good morning, Chapel Hill. How are y'all this morning? Did you all survive the weather that we had Thursday? That was rough. Did anybody have house damage, yard damage, anybody? I know some people said their fences blew down. We want to welcome everybody as we're coming in here. I know that we've had some time of fellowship this morning, but I want to welcome everybody as they come in. If you're visiting with us, we are so glad that you're here. We are glad that you've chosen to come in here and worship with us this morning. We don't count that as something that we deserve. It is a privilege to be able to come before the Lord, and we are glad that you've come alongside us today to worship. We would love to get some information from you. We would love to share some information about our church with you, and we would love to answer any questions. And in front of you in some of the chairs, it's kind of every other chair, there's a blue card. If you wouldn't mind filling that out, it's just ask for three questions, and you can drop it in the offering buckets when they pass by later in the service. I have a guest that's coming to make an announcement. I'm going to let her go first.
Good morning. We are so excited. I'm so excited. All of us are so excited about an event that has truly been ordained from the Lord. It's just a beautiful story of how this all worked out. So, so thankful for our church. So we're going to have Chapel Hill Women's Conference, April the 22nd. And the theme for that is Truth Be Told, teaching how God's truth can replace the lies the enemy tells all of us. Amen. And so I'm going to be speaking at that. A dear friend of mine, Jen Kish, who is out of Chattanooga, who is a wonderful woman of God, is going to be coming and joining us. Of course, we have our own very talented Rachel Williams is going to be singing, and Megan Allen, that leads the Renaissance Choir. Y'all know Megan. So it's going to be April the 22nd here at Chapel Hill at 6 p.m. The deadline for registration is Easter, April the 9th. Individual tickets are $30. That includes a catered dinner. Six ladies to a table for $150. So you get one lady in free if you get a whole table. Groups of eight or more, contact Anisha about that. And it's just going to be a great night. Please, if you can volunteer to help in any way or get your girlfriends together, get a group together to get a table, that would be wonderful. But also, just be in prayer for this event, that many women of this community come in here, women who have never heard the gospel for the first time come in here, and that souls are going to be saved. We are already trusting in the Lord that this is going to be a great event, and that it's just going to have an eternal impact. So please be in prayer about that, and we would love to have you join us. Again, April the 22nd, dinner at 6 and service at 7. Thank y'all.
Thank you, Susanna. I have two more announcements to make. Our youth, Jamie and Bobby and the other youth leaders in here, our youth, they did this last year. It was a lip sync battle, and we had a blast. Everyone that was there, we had a blast. The kids had a blast. It's a fundraiser for our students to go to camp. And so we are encouraging everyone to come out. And there is a sign-up sheet online or on the app, or they brought some stuff to Sunday school classrooms today. If you want to come to that, that's going to be another catered meal. And Justin Coleman over here is going to be grilling again. I think people are still talking about that from last year. But Justin's going to be grilling, and it will be chicken, I believe, and sides that go with that. And that will be the dinner, and then your entertainment will be the students or whoever, if any of you want to participate in a lip sync battle. We learned that there's some people in here who have some secret talents that we didn't know about last night, so I don't have to call them out, but we feel like there's other people in this church that have some secret talents that could be a part of the lip sync battle. And that's going to be the 19th, so that's in a few weeks. So sign up, see Jamie. The two sign-ups are online at chapelhillonline.net, and they're also outside, or not your Sunday school classrooms. The other announcement is we're going to be doing a different event for Easter this year for our families. We're going to be doing a spring family picnic. It's not just for kids, parents with kids, it's for the entire church. So it's our church community coming together. And so that's going to be on the Sunday before Easter after church at 4 o'clock. But before that, we need pre-filled Easter eggs. There will be an Easter egg hunt for our kids. So we need pre-filled Easter eggs, and you can drop those off at the church. And there's buckets throughout the church to drop those off. So everybody, if you could bring your pre-filled Easter eggs, that would be great. I'm going to pray for us, and then I'm going to turn it over for worship. God, we come before you, and Lord, you are a good God. And Lord, I pray as we are coming in here to worship you, Lord, remind us that what this is about. It is about our hearts, and it's about our focus on you and exalting you in all of our life. Lord, thank you so much for what Jesus did for us on the cross and in the grave, and the truth about the story of who God is and how much you love us. In your name I pray, amen.
We serve a great God. Let's worship. Oh, Lord, my God. Hornets, by the way. So I'm reading from Psalms 138, 1 through 3. With all my heart, I praise you, Lord. In the presence of angels, I sing your praises. I worship at your holy temple and praise you for your love and your faithfulness. You were true to your word and made yourself more famous than ever before. When I asked for your help, you answered my prayer and gave me courage. Again, Psalm 138, 1 through 3. So as we continue to worship in song, we have the opportunity as well to worship by our tithes and offerings. If you would, in the center aisles, pass it over to your left or your right, and we'll continue to worship.
Anticipating this day, let's worship together as to the all ages.
Trumpet calls so loud.
There's no God like Jehovah. We believe that. Amen. Let's sing it.
There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah.
Thank you.
Acts chapter 2 verse 14 through 40. And I like to do this. If you were here last time, you know, I want to ask you if you're willing and able, if you wouldn't mind stand in honor of the reading of God's word. And I like to begin this way because I want the word of God to set the precedence for what's taking place here today. Listen to Acts 2 verse 14. Luke writes, "Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Amen. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders and signs which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. David said about him, I saw the Lord always before me, because he is at my right hand. I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body also will rest in hope, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead. You will not let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. Fellow Israelites, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. But he was a prophet and knew that God had promised him on oath that he would place on one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. God has raised this Jesus to life. And we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. For David did not ascend to heaven, and yet he said, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Therefore, let all the house of Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. This is the word of God. You may be seated, and let us pray together. Father, this is a divine moment. A matter of hearing the Almighty God speak through his word. It's a matter of truth. It's a matter of life and death. It is a matter of eternity. This moment, Lord, you knew from the beginning of time would be right now. For all of our days are written in your book. And Lord, you have sanctioned and sanctified this moment of the gathering of the church and the preaching of the Word of God to be the life of the church. Through it, you build your church. Through it, you add to your church. Through it, you save people. So Lord, tonight, right now, this morning, as we enter into this moment, we ask, Lord, that what we yet do not know and understand, you would teach us. What we do not yet have, would you give us. And what we have not yet become, would you make us. And we pray this in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Have you ever had that experience of something that you were just really waiting on? I mean, something you were anticipating, something you were looking forward to in life, whatever that might be. that thing that you've been waiting on for maybe months or weeks, maybe even years or longer. It's something good, something exciting, something big. And you know that feeling, that anticipation of looking forward to it. Maybe it was a certain event that you were going to attend. Maybe it was that trip or that vacation that you had been wanting to go on, and y'all had been planning and preparing and saving, and you waited and waited and waited, and the day comes and you get to go. Or maybe it was that first child or that baby. You waited and waited and waited, and then you waited those 9 months, and then the baby comes. Or maybe it was just something you were saving up for, and you finally get it. Or maybe it's a new change in life, or a new season in life. Whatever it is, whatever it was, and whatever time it came into your life, you were anticipating it. And then that moment comes when it finally arrives. And you go, wow, this is great. This is what I've been looking forward to. This is what I've been waiting on. This is what I've been anticipating. And it's finally here. And you know what's even more wonderful is it's even better than I thought. We've all had those kind of moments. Well, that's what happened here in Acts chapter 2. It was a time that the Old Testament had anticipated. It was a time the Old Testament had looked forward to and had prophesied. Even Jesus himself had told his disciples about this day, even in the first chapter of Acts in verses 4 and 5. Now, right before our passage, you probably know or are familiar with Acts chapter 2 and what's happened, but 120 disciples had been gathered together based on Jesus' command to them to go to Jerusalem and to gather together and to wait for the promised Holy Spirit. So they've been gathered together in this room in Jerusalem, and they've been praying together for days and weeks, just as their risen Lord had told them to. It was the day of Pentecost, 50 days after Passover, and the Holy Spirit of God was unleashed. The Holy Spirit of God was poured out. Not just a little bit, not just a trickle. The word means a deluge. God poured out his Spirit, and these believers began to speak the praises of God and the word of God in languages, in tongues that they did not know, in languages that were unknown to them. And all the people that were gathered for Pentecost, Jews that would be gathered from all over that had been scattered, they were hearing them speak in all these different languages and dialects, and they understood them. Now that's a miracle. And this created quite a stir among all these Jews gathered there in Jerusalem. I mean, they heard all this, and they're dumbfounded. They actually accused these believers of having a soup full already that morning. I mean, they were looking around going, these people are soused. These people have had enough. They're lit. They've been drinking early, way too early. Peter stands up to address the crowds, and he explains what's happened and why it's happened. In other words, he doesn't just tell them what's going on, he tells them the reason it's going on and what it all means. And so what Luke gives us here on this Pentecost morning is he gives us a condensed version, sort of a summary, if you will, the cliff notes, if you will, of Peter's sermon. It's the first Christian sermon publicly recorded, and it's the Christian sermon that God uses to start the church. This is how Christianity began, officially. Jesus had fulfilled all of Israel's promises and hopes and expectations, and the time that they had anticipated for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years had come. And I think that if we could boil the message down just to a phrase or sentence or so, or what I want to put before you today for your consideration is this: the time is now, and there's no time like right now. The time is now, and there's no time like right now. Now let me show you why I believe, and I think Peter believes, that this is the case. Three things this morning, or really two main points, and then a point of application as well. The first thing is this. The first reason why the time is now is because the last days are already here. I've had people ask me in my ministry through the years, Brother Michael, do you think that the last days are here? Do you think we're living in the last days? And I say, we've been living in them for 2,000 years. We've been living in them for 2,000 years. Because Peter actually tells these people on this day that that's what happened. The day that the Holy Spirit came, the last days were inaugurated. They were ushered in. And so when all these Jews asked what was going on, Peter simply says, hey, this is the fulfillment of your scriptures. This is the fulfillment of the prophets. This is the fulfillment of what everything God had promised that we've been looking forward to. It was the time of the Spirit, the messianic age. You see, in the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit was active. The Holy Spirit would come upon people chosen by God to do certain things. He would come upon them. He would anoint them and empower them, whether it was to serve or to lead or to prophesy. But there was something different about the New Covenant age that was coming, about the Messianic age, about these last days. In the New Covenant, the Spirit was going to do a work of new creation. He was going to renew and restore God's people, God's true people. He was going to build God's true temple. The Holy Spirit was going to cleanse and change people's hearts and give life to the dead and indwell God's people. And all of God's people would be taught and empowered by the very Spirit of God. That's Ezekiel 36. But even Jesus in John 14 said himself that he had to go away. He had to go back to the Father, and when he did, he would send the Helper, the Advocate. He would come, and the Spirit would not just be, listen to this, not just be with us, he would live in us. Hey, get your prepositions right, amen? He won't just be with you, he will be in you. And he will never forsake you, and he would live in God's people to teach them and empower them. This is the time that has come at Pentecost, and it's been here ever since. Now, the way Peter proves this, though, is he goes right to the scriptures, and he talks about what Joel specifically said in Joel 2. The words there in your text, in our English translations, and right here in Acts, that Luke is quoting from Peter, is in verses 17 through 21. Here in 17 through 21, Luke, or Peter, is quoting Joel 2. And basically what, in essence, Peter says is, this is that. This that's going on, this that you're seeing, this that you're experiencing, this that is happening to us, this day is that which Joel talked about. It's taking place. These are the days of fulfillment. This is the time of fulfillment. Now, what does all this mean? Two things. First, it means that the presence of the Spirit is for all of God's people. It's for all of God's people. Look, Peter literally says here, the way Luke writes it is that at this time that the Spirit was poured out, it was poured out, the NIV says, on all people. Literally, it's all flesh. All flesh. That was not the case in the Old Testament. Again, God would pour out his Spirit and would anoint certain people for certain tasks, but it wasn't for everyone. That's why Moses says, I wish that all of God's people could prophesy. It's for all of God's people without distinction. It's for all of God's people without exception. In other words, there will be no barriers between God pouring out his Spirit on believers. And there will be no ethnic barriers, no Jew or Gentile. There will be no gender barriers between male or female. Both men and women will have the Spirit of God. There will be no social barriers between slave or free or rich or poor. There will be no age barriers. It will be both young and old. The Holy Spirit has come to live inside of and empower once and for all believers indiscriminately and impartially. But there's a second thing that this means. It means that salvation is available for all peoples. This is connected in the text. The Spirit can come upon all people. Because the Spirit has brought the blessings of salvation, one for Christ, and salvation is for all people, and we see that in the text. Notice that when Peter says that the last days are here, one of the things that has come in with the last days, he says, is the day of the Lord. Now, what is the day of the Lord? Again, that's Old Testament language. These Jews, from their own scriptures, should know this. The day of the Lord could be spoken of to talk about God intervening in history and intervening in time to bring about judgment upon his enemies. So, for instance, when God came in and judged Babylon, when he came in and he judged Assyria, and even when he had the Babylonians come in and overthrow Jerusalem, and to overthrow Israel, and Assyria overthrow the northern kingdom, that was talked about as the day of the Lord. It was a day that God was intervening to bring judgment. But it also could speak about God's salvation. Because God sometimes would judge his enemies and deliver his people. And so sometimes it's both. It's a day of judgment, a day of salvation that would happen. And along with these days of the Lord, if you will, came this apocalyptic language. This language that has this connotation of cataclysmic, end time, life-changing, earth-shattering type of events. For instance, in verses 19 through 21, you see it? We read about wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below and blood and fire and billows of smoke and the sun we turn to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. That's apocalyptic language. Now, usually when we read that language about the constellations, something happening in the constellations, and we read about blood and fire and pillows of smoke, we think about the coming of Christ. And that language is used to talk about the coming of Christ. But that language is also used about other major events, salvation, historical events. And I think what Peter is saying here is this. In one sense, he's saying that what Joel foretold about the last days and this day of the Lord, it's already here. The day of salvation is here. The time of salvation is here. I mean, think about Jesus and his life and what happened around his death and resurrection. His life was accompanied by signs and wonders. At Calvary, the sun was darkened and it was dark for 3 hours. When Jesus died, there was an earthquake. The tombs were open. The curtain in the temple was split from top to bottom. Jesus was raised from the dead, and he ascended in a cloud. And now in Acts 2, right before our chapter, right before our passage, you have tongues like flames of fire coming upon these people. I think what Peter is saying is this, that the day of the Lord has already begun. The great and glorious day of the Lord's salvation is upon us because the Spirit's everywhere. Salvation is for everyone who calls on the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Salvation is available for all peoples, all people everywhere. There is no people, there is no person excluded from the gospel. The gospel holds out the promises of salvation for all people. So I say to you right now, today is the day of salvation. This time is the time of salvation. There is coming a time when this time will not be. There is coming a time when Jesus will return and the day of judgment will come. And I want to tell you, dear friend, it will be a terrible day for those who do not know Christ. But now is the day of salvation. Now is the day of the Lord. Salvation is available now. And no one is forbidden here in this text from calling on the name of the Lord to be saved. But there's a second reason why the time is now and there's no time like right now, and that is this. Jesus is the exalted Lord. Jesus is the exalted Lord. Did you notice what Peter does? After he quotes the scriptures, he turns everything to Jesus. You know why? Because all the scriptures are about Jesus. Even Jesus said, the law, the prophets, the Psalms, the writings, all of it is about me. He turns everything to Jesus. And he says, basically, let me show you how and why all of this is happening. How and why we're living in these last days is because Jesus is the Messiah and Lord. And this is how he does it. He goes to the Scriptures. And he proves it from the Scriptures, from the Old Testament, which was their Scriptures. And also, of course, from their own experience. He says, this Jesus, Jesus of Nazareth. And then he reminds them of things they know. What did he say? He said, first of all, God identified this man. In other words, God marked him out. God attested to him by how? By signs and wonders. Now, Jesus was a man from Nazareth. And that's how most of them knew him. He was a real man with real human flesh. He lived a real human life. And he was a man from Nazareth, that scum of the earth, the backwoods place that nobody wanted to be from. He was ashamed to even say the name. They knew this. They were aware of who Jesus was. Many of them knew him. Many of them had heard him. And they had seen the signs and wonders. But Jesus was no ordinary man. He was not less than a man, but he was more than a man. God marked him out. And all these signs that Jesus did were indicators that he was God's Messiah. That they indicated who he was, and they indicated the presence of the kingdom right now. Jesus, what he was doing, giving hearing to the deaf, giving sight to the blind, raising the dead to life, healing people of uncleanness and impurities and diseases and all these things, they were all signs that the time has come. The kingdom is at hand. It is broken through in Jesus. But not only was he identified by God, he was offered up by God. You see, many of these people, they knew who Jesus was. They had heard him. They had seen him. But they rejected him. They rejected him. They didn't want to have anything to do with him. Or they held him at arm's length. He was not the kind of Messiah they wanted or they expected. He didn't do what they wanted him to do, overthrow Rome and set up a geopolitical national kingdom. So the leaders, they sought to kill him. Judas betrayed him. And the crowds wanted him crucified. And that they did. And Peter indicts them. Did you see that? In verse 23, at the end of 23, it says, "And you," God attested to him, God pointed him out, "but you," notice that, "and you, with the help of these wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross." But at the same time, this was all part of God's sovereign plan. Did you see the first part of verse 23? Look at it. "This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge." It's true that the Jews and the Romans, and many of these Jews that were even there that day, they had Jesus killed. They chanted, "Crucify." They were there. They shook their heads. They mocked. They spat. They did all of those things. They wanted him dead. And Peter says, "And you are guilty. You are responsible. You are culpable. You killed God's Messiah." But at the same time, this was not plan B. This was not an accident. God wasn't up there scratching his head going, oh my, dear heavens, I didn't know this was going to happen. Peter says that it was the predetermined plan of God for the salvation of sinners. You see, both of those things are simultaneously true. You can't work that out in your head, and I can't work that out in my head, but the Bible says it is there. He says it's both, right? You did it. You're guilty. You're responsible. But yet, it's all a part of God's sovereign plan. Do you remember Joseph in Genesis? Boy, there's a lot of comparisons. There's analogies between him and Christ, right? I mean, he's betrayed by his brothers. He's thrown into the dungeon. He's accused. All these things. And what did he tell his brothers at the end of it all? "What you meant for evil, God intended it for good."
Amen.
Isn't this amazing? Isn't it amazing? This wicked and unjust act intended by these wicked sinners, God ordained for them to be the means of saving sinners just like them. Don't you love our God? the way he flips things on their head. You see, atonement had to be made to God for sin. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. All of the Old Testament had all of these sacrifices, right, where the lamb or the animal was substituted on behalf of sinners. But now God has sent his own lamb. God has sent his own son, and he slays him on the cross. It was his pleasure, his delight to crush him, Isaiah 53 says. And he did it so that even those who crucified him could be reconciled to God. But notice, not only did God identify him and did God hand him over and offer him up, but God raised him. I love verse 24. He told them, but you nailed him to the cross. Verse 24. But God raised him from the dead. You see, what man did wasn't final. God's in charge. And they were eyewitnesses. And what Peter does is this, because you know, this is something they didn't want, these Jews didn't want to believe, right? They didn't want to believe Jesus was the Messiah. But what he does is he goes right to the scriptures. He goes to Psalm 16. And he quotes David, who he says is prophetically talking, not about himself. David's not talking about David. David is talking about someone greater. He's talking about the Messiah. And he says in Psalm 16 that God will raise the Messiah from the dead. And Peter goes there and says, hey, this is what David said himself. And by the way, David wasn't talking about himself. He was speaking prophetically. You can go to the tomb of David, and guess what? The remains are going to be there. Verse 31 and 32, look at it. Seeing what was to come, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. And who is this one, this Messiah? God has raised this Jesus. Do you see that? This Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. If you go to the tomb of Jesus today, ain't nobody home. You know why? Because he was God's chosen Messiah. And he was so holy and so righteous, the Holy One, that the grave couldn't hold him. God vindicated him. You see, the resurrection wasn't just a miracle, dear friend. The resurrection was an exclamation point. God said, hey, I told you. Peter's saying to this crowd, hey, he told us. Jesus said himself, they will hand me over, betray me, kill me, and on the third day I will rise. But then he was exalted by God. Because Jesus is the crucified one and the risen one, he is the exalted one. Look at verse 36. Peter's already told us he's exalted at the right hand of God. And then he says in verse 36, God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both the Lord and Messiah. Do you know what that means today, dear friend? It means that all authority, all power, all honor, all sovereignty belongs to Jesus. He is Lord. And you know what? You can try to argue with it. You can try to suppress it. You can try to ignore it. You can try to run from it. But you can't change it. He's Lord. He's Lord of all. This is the good news. This is the gospel, dear friend. This is the gospel. That God sent his own Son in the flesh to live a righteous and holy life, to die an atoning sin-justifying, wrath-absorbing death, to be raised and vindicated from the grave and exalted to the Father's right hand. And now he is Lord. And all of this has been done so that condemned sinners can be saved and reconciled to God. But you must respond. That's the third thing. You see, the time is now because we're living in the last days. The time is now because Jesus is the exalted Lord. And the time is now because you are required to respond. Now, if Jesus is Lord, and he has won and secured all the blessings of salvation that he holds out to all people in the gospel, they are his to bestow. You can't go to anyone else. There is only forgiveness. There's only reconciliation. There's only salvation. The Spirit of God is only available to those who come to Jesus. Amen. What does the Lord require? Well, first, let me say this. Let me note this. Salvation isn't something that we do. Are we all on the same page there? Right? Salvation isn't something that we do. Christianity, salvation, becoming a Christian, isn't something we do. Salvation is something that God has already done for us. Right? Listen. Christianity happens to us. Conversion happens to us and in us. Notice that these Jews, just a few weeks earlier, had a certain view of Jesus. They did not receive him as a Messiah, and they wanted him killed. But Peter says in verse 37, when they heard this message, what message? The gospel. Notice what it says. They were cut to the heart, and they said, brothers, what shall we do? What must we do? What is required of us? You see, they were convicted of their own sin. They felt the burden of their own guilt. They all of a sudden knew that they needed forgiveness. Their whole understanding and view of who Jesus is and what he came to do has been changed now. That didn't happen overnight. It didn't happen because they thought long and hard about it. It didn't happen because they tried it out. It happened because it's only the power of the Spirit of God through the preached Word of God that can even happen. Peter preached, the Holy Spirit was active in the Word, and the Holy Spirit convicted them. They're awakened, they're persuaded, the truth of the gospel has now become personal to them. I know that's what happened to me. Has that happened to you? Something you didn't want, something you didn't know, something you didn't think about or give much attention to, all of a sudden, there's a change in you. It's only explained by the powerful grace of the Holy Spirit working in the Word of God. There's no other explanation. Conversion is God's work. It happens to us. It starts with God, and it's the power of the Holy Spirit. Maybe today you are convicted of your sin against God. You feel the burden of your own guilt. You know that you need forgiveness. You know that things need to be put right. You know that there is a judgment that you are facing. What must you do, though? Because God requires a response. Salvation is what God does, but he requires a response. What must you do? If you're going to receive the benefits of what Christ has done, you must respond. What does Peter say in verse 38? Look at it. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. I say to you today, dear friend, you must repent. Jesus said, unless you repent, you likewise will perish. You must repent. You say, oh, well, I've heard that language before. Can I just say, repentance is not turning over a new leaf. Repentance is not just trying harder, trying to do better, trying to get your act together. When people say, oh, they just need to get their act together, they can't. Right? Because we're going to do what our sin nature wants us to do. No, you need a repentance. You need to repent. Repentance means that you have a change of mind leading to a change of action. It means that you have a total reorientation of life, and all of that is reoriented around God and His Christ and His truth. Repentance means that you have a change of mind about your sin and about God and His Son and your need for a Savior. Have you repented? I didn't ask if you came to church. I didn't ask if your name was on the Sunday school roll. I didn't ask if you tagged on the shirt tails of your mom and dad all your life. I ask you this. Have you repented? Are you repenting? Is there a change in your life brought about by the Spirit of God through the Word of God?
Amen.
The other thing you must do is believe. Now, you don't see that command in this text, but it's implied. How do I know that? Because repentance and faith are two sides of the same coin. They go together. In other words, you can't have one without the other. To truly repent means to believe. And to truly believe means to repent. True repentance results in faith. And true faith, it goes right along with repentance. Jesus said, repent and believe. Paul said he preached repentance toward God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. Elsewhere in Acts, we see the command may not be repent, but it might be just believe. For instance, do you remember what happened with the Philippian jailer in Acts 16, verse 30, when there's a great earthquake and the prison break there in Philippi? Acts 16, 30. Sirs, the jailer says, what must I do to be saved? What did Paul say? Paul said, believe in the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved. Are you believing? Have you believed? And then he says, be baptized. Repent and be baptized. Now, repentance implies faith, but baptism also implies faith. Because it's an obedient act of faith. See, baptism is the public way biblically to declare one's faith in Jesus. Jesus said his followers are to identify themselves with him by being baptized in his name. That's the way we mark them out in the church. Baptism is a sign and a seal of one's faith and commitment to Christ. It's the initiation right into the church. And I want to say this. Baptism is the only biblical public profession of faith. The only ones that were counted in Acts 2, those 3,000, were those who followed through in their faith publicly in baptism. It's a command we don't need to neglect. Now, Peter's not saying that baptism secures forgiveness. We know that it's by faith alone that we are justified before Christ. It's by faith in Christ that we're justified before God and faith alone. But you see, baptism in the name of Jesus goes right along with faith and repentance in the New Testament. These three are kind of linked. Faith or repentance, faith and baptism. They're so closely connected in this idea of becoming a Christian. Right? Of one's conversion in the New Testament. They're so closely linked that to talk about one is basically to imply the others. That's why in some places the Bible says, or New Testament says, repent. Other places it says, believe. Other ones say, be baptized. Why? Because all of them imply the other. And I want to say this, the apostles wouldn't know anything of an unbaptized Christian. But I want you to notice this. Notice what Peter says. Repent and be baptized, every one of you. Why every one of us? Brother Michael, I'm a good guy. Brother Michael, I'm moral. I have conservative views. I try not to do too much of this or too much of that. I'm better than my neighbor. I try to go to church over Chapel Hill and do all these things. But he says, repent every one of you. Why? Because the Bible unequivocally says that we have all sinned. We have all sinned. Listen closely. And we're fixing to be done. I want to say to you today on all the authority of the Word of God, you will not and no one will ever be saved without exercising repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. No one. Doesn't matter who you are. Red, yellow, black, or white. Conservative or liberal. Young or old. Moral, immoral. Knowledge of God, not knowledge of God. Doesn't matter. No one. God never saves anyone without them exercising repentance and faith. So be assured of this today. You and I are sinners. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. If you're here today and the Spirit of God has convicted you, you've been pricked in your heart, your conscience has been wounded, you feel the weight of your sin and the burden of your guilt, I want you to know that you and I deserve every ounce of God's judgment. But if you've heard the gospel today, and you've been convicted today, and you've been persuaded today, and all of a sudden things are looking a lot different than they were, and God's opening your eyes, and you're feeling that wooing and that drawing by the Spirit of God, and you know that the threat of judgment is real, and you know you need to be forgiven because you yourself have sinned, and you need to be forgiven, and you want to be forgiven, know this. Jesus Christ came to save sinners. And he did what he did so that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord can be saved. He did it so that everyone who repents from their sin and places their faith in Christ will be forgiven of their sin. Forgiven. Once and for all, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit living in you. You know how I know this promise is for you? Not only because it says everyone who repents and believes will be saved, but look at verse 39. Peter says, this promise is for you and your children and all afar off whom the Lord will call to himself. Friend, there is no time like right now. Today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of repentance and faith for some of you. So with Peter, as he goes on and says, 39 and 40, I plead with you. Come to Christ today. You sit there today and you say, I need Christ. I need to be forgiven. I know that I'm a sinner and I'm under the wrath of God and I want to get things right today. Come to Christ today. I plead with you. Turn from your sin. Place your faith in Christ. Receive this wonderful gift of forgiveness and life that only God can give you today.